So today we begin to look at the text of Daniel Defoe, Moll Flanders. I am basically following a synopsis, detailed synopsis that I made from the Norton Critical Edition, and I refer to the page numbers of the Norton Edition. So it is, of course, always a lot of pleasure to handle the book itself, but since the thing that I have in my hand is next to the book, therefore it will be almost the same. So on page 9 of the novel, Moll explains why she writes her autobiography under a pseudonym. So Moll Flanders is a pseudonym, and on page 9 the writer explains why she has to take the help of a pseudonym. Her mother was caught for petty theft and brought to Newgate prison. She pleaded her belly as she was pregnant and got a respite for 7 months. So in this novel we see a depiction of the very harsh laws that were there in England. For many years, for centuries, petty theft was considered a great crime. And in Renaissance England, people were even executed for petty theft, which we find in Thomas More's Utopia, a reference to this criminal law, which the traveller Raphael Hitlode criticizes as unjust. And in the 18th century also we see that still people were imprisoned and sometimes executed for petty theft if repeated offences could be proved, then they would be executed. Now there was an option. Sometimes there was an option of choosing transportation, that is, transportation to the colonies, recently or rather newly established colonies in America, particularly Virginia, which had large tobacco plantations, and the English made it a practice to send their criminals to the colonies like America and Australia. So here we see another reference to the custom of women prisoners. If they could establish that they were pregnant, then they won't be hanged, and in that case they would be transported. So this was called pleading the belly. And we see that Moll's mother did the same because she was really pregnant, but often people also falsely claim to be pregnant in order to avoid a death sentence. But Moll's mother was really pregnant, and she gave birth to Moll in Newgate prison. So she pleaded the belly, and she was given the option of transportation to America. Moll was born in the prison. Her mother's death penalty was transmuted to transportation, and she was sent to Virginia. Since there was no orphanage in England, unlike in France, Moll was taken care of by gypsies. So this is another thing that Defoe exposes the defect of the system of justice in England. The welfare system was not at all developed at that time, and there were no orphanages. So today we cannot even imagine a situation where there was no orphanage, but Defoe writes that in England at that time there was no orphanage, but there were orphanages in France. So France, the traditional rival of England, has been depicted in a good light here, in a better light, because they had orphanages, whereas in England there was none. And therefore, after her mother was deported not deported, transported to Virginia. She was, taken care of by some gypsies. So we see that the utter lack of welfare system. There was like no home for children or orphanage and so on. Now what kind of education the gypsies could give, we can well imagine. The gypsies were also suspected to be thieves. And they were nomadic, they moved from one place to another. Even today in Europe, there are many gypsies. They are called Romas. And the Romas are there in most European countries, particularly in the poor countries like the East European countries. And it is believed that some of these came to Europe, and they came to Europe from India, like from Punjab or Rajasthan and so on. So the gypsies were not a very, happy group, to say the least, with which a child could be entrusted. But Moll had no option. But at least they took care of her for 3 years, till she was 3 years old. Then on page 11 to 16, they left Moll in Colchester in Essex, or Moll left them at the age of 3. So the author keeps it ambiguous whether the gypsies leave her or she leaves them, because most likely that she won't remember what happened when she was only 3 years old. But the parish house put her in the charge of a virtuous nurse who was like her mother. So the parish was kind of a municipality, the local body, and the authority of the local body put her in charge of a nurse. Now this nurse was a decent woman, also educated, but obviously very poor. But nevertheless, she took charge of the girl. She also ran a school, and Moll got genteel education. So genteel education, that is education of the gentleman class. Women received an education which was limited in many ways compared to the education given to men. And women were educated at home or, a school run at home. She stayed with, she got training in manners and dancing. So this kind of school for girl children, they were often called finishing schools or so. Like they were trained in sewing, knitting, table manners, social manners, dancing and so on. In other words, they were given the training for being a housewife or person who can be also sociable, who can chat or make good conversations and so on. There was no other purpose behind this education. Women were not supposed to have a career of their own. She stayed with her till the age of 8. Moll was supposed to take up service, but she refused. Why? Because the local parish, they entrusted her to this nurse, and it was believed that from the age of 8, children could be given employment. So we know that in modern times, we ban the employment of children below a certain age. Child labor is banned, but there was no such law at that time. Therefore, Moll could have entered the service of some household and could have earned for herself and her maintenance. But she was terribly afraid of service, and she cried so much that she could not be put into any service, and she said that she wanted to be a lady. So the mayoress took pity on her, and the mayoress had a friend, a woman. Moll was supposed to take up service, but she refused and wanted to be a gentle lady. The mayoress and her two daughters gave her money and clothing, and another lady who was a friend of the mayoress kept Moll at her place for some time. So we see that there was some kind of charity available, which was the substitute for social welfare by the state, because the state did not organize any such welfare. So ordinary people, because Christians also believe in charity, so ordinary people would, you know, be charitable to those who did not have any support. Today, of course, the social welfare system is very well developed in Europe and in England. And if you are unemployed, then you will get a check from the state. I stayed with an Indian friend in London for a few months, and he was unemployed in the sense that he worked in a shop. He was a Gujarati and he worked in a shop. Therefore, officially he was unemployed. So every Sunday the postman would come and deliver a check for a few $100, a few £100. So that was quite, you know, interesting. The postman would come regularly on Sunday mornings and deliver the check. But we are talking about the 18th century. So she was supported by the two daughters of the mayoress with money and clothing. And the lady kept her for some time. So actually, Moll stayed with that lady for a week. Then she came back to her nurse mother and again continued to stay with the nurse mother until the age of 14, when the nurse died. So we may say that in her childhood, the nurse was kind of her mother, who gave her all the basic trainings. Page 17 to 20, Moll was frightened because she was all alone. I would ask you to read the lines in the novel, and Defoe represents the emotions in the girl who loses her mother or mother-like figure in the nurse, and she was afraid to be all alone. So she returned to the lady who had earlier kept her for a week. Moll continued to stay in this house till she was 17 or 18. By this time, you may imagine that she has grown into a young woman, a teenager of 17 or 18 years old, and teenagers develop some vanity. As you know, young girls, they love to look into the mirror at the reflection, because they become aware of their beauty, you know, their charm and so on. So that also happened to Moll. And by this time she had grown vanity for her good looks. The lady had two sons and two daughters. Moll had the same education in French, singing and dancing as the daughters. So the two daughters were educated at home, and Moll was also educated along with them in French, singing and dancing. French was taught to the gentle class, the gentlemen and ladies, because particularly the ladies, because French was considered as a language of culture or cultivation. So one who knew some French would be accepted as a cultured person. So she was educated like a gentlewoman, and in this she was quite lucky. Then the lady had two sons, and the elder son seduced her and she fell in love with him. The sister said about Moll, so there is this quotation. And why is it important? Because it represents the status of women in society. The sister says that Betty wants but one thing. She is referring to Moll. Betty was the common name for any maid in England. So Moll was, she had the position of a maid in the house. So the sister says, Betty wants but one thing, but she has good want everything, as good want everything, for the market is against our sex just now. Which means that she lacked only one thing, but that was tantamount to lacking everything. And if a young woman have beauty, birth, breeding, wit, sense, manners, modesty, and all these to an extreme, yet if she have no money, she is nobody. She had as good want them all, for nothing but money now recommends a woman. The men play the game all into their own hands. So we notice two things here, that Defoe makes money a very important consideration in this novel, because that indicates that in the 18th century, the age of high capitalism, capitalism was developing very fast. Then money replaced all other considerations and became of prior importance to people, particularly to the English. So we know that the English are very money-minded. Whenever there is any transaction, even a social relationship or exchange like marriage, then immediately they would calculate the worth of the groom and the bride. So how much the groom possessed, how much wealth the groom possessed, and how much bride possessed. That is, the financial status of the individuals always came into consideration. And even though in this novel Defoe represents the career of Moll as a picaresque heroine, as a person who gradually rises out of poverty and ends up by having sufficient wealth and returns to England from America. So at every stage the author gives us an indication of how much Moll was worth at that point of time. That is, how much money she had. And we see that Moll had many ups and downs. That is, she was not always poor or not always rich. Her financial status constantly changed. So that also suggests the instability, the financial instability and uncertainty in the life of a person in the 18th century, and the danger of bankruptcy always loomed large, because at any point anybody could become bankrupt and then that person would be prosecuted, because strangely bankruptcy was considered a crime. Well, even today it is a crime, because when you become bankrupt, then you cannot pay your creditors, and the creditors will be compensated for by taking away your property and everything, even in today's law. So this is an indication of the elevation of money in society as a value, replacing all other values. So the sister says that if a woman has all other qualities like beauty, birth, breeding, wit, sense, manners, modesty, and she has these in plenty, even then she will be worth nothing if she does not have money. Why? Because the market is against our sex. So the society was looked upon as a market where everybody has a price, everybody has a value in economic terms. A financial value, financial price could be settled on everybody, and virtues or modesty, beauty, these qualities, they did not have any financial value. So it was of no use if you had qualities, if you had character, if you had virtues. They were of no value, they were of no use if you did not have money. Therefore, Defoe presents a society which is extremely money-centric, and the consideration of money is very important here. And then the men play the game all into their own hands. So the sister looks at the relationship between men and women first as a market. Women come to the market as commodities, and they have to bargain or they have to compete with men. And then she looks at it as a game, that is a gambling or a card game, where if you can, if you have sufficient tricks, then you can win in a card game or gambling. So if a woman does not have money, then she lacks the most important cards, and the men play their hands very well, which means that such women, they do not find any acceptance even in the marriage market or in society. Page 23, Moll is given money by the elder son in lieu of sexual favors. So initially it was love, but love is not represented here platonically. Love would always lead to lust, and the elder son asked for sexual favors, but he is not a bad person in the pejorative sense, or sarcastically we may say that he is not a bad person. He is not a bad person actually, because he thinks that if he gets something from Moll, even sexual favors, then he should pay her. And he offers her money. Now the question is whether a woman should accept money in exchange of sexual favors. A virtuous woman would deny giving sexual favor to anybody in exchange of money, because that would be some kind of prostitution. But Moll says that I had many vices, plenty of vanity, but very little stock of virtue. So we have a self-analysis of the character, and she says that at that young age, I fell in love, so I also had desire. So it was almost kind of reciprocal. But if it is reciprocal love, then there should not be any exchange of money. But Moll accepted the money. And she writes that I was more troubled by accepting the money than because of, having a sexual affair with the elder brother. So what kind of trouble she had by accepting the money? The trouble was moral or ethical. That is, she went down a few steps below in the moral criteria by accepting money. She comments, I had a most unbounded stock of vanity and pride, and but a very little stock of virtue. Thus I gave up myself to a readiness of being ruined without the least concern, and am a fair memento to all young women whose vanity prevails over their virtue. So Moll says that at that young age, what I did, that is a memento, that is an example which should warn other young women. So one should be cautious by looking at my example, that one should not prioritize sex over virtue or money over virtue. She says that vanity prevails over their virtue. So Moll's analysis is that she accepted money because of her vanity, that is, her vanity and pride made her think little about morality. The elder son assured her that in case she got pregnant, I will take care of you and provide for you. And with that he pulls out a silk purse with 100 guineas in it and gave it to me. And I will give you such another, says he, every year till I marry you. So the elder son knew that whether you have a concubine which was not unusual at all in that age. Even in Bengal in the 19th century, having concubine was very common. So whether you have a concubine or you have a wife, you must pay maintenance. Now this is something that even today in the legal system in India, which is shadow of the British legal system, it almost follows the British laws everywhere. So even today, on the issue of maintenance, on the question of maintenance to be given to women by their husbands or whatever partners, that is held very important by the court, by the Indian courts. So there is no alternative to that, and the elder brother was not unwilling to pay her. So he gave her a lot of money. 100 guineas meant a lot, and he told her that I will give you such a purse every year, which means that he kept Moll as a concubine by paying her money, and until I marry you. So he also promised her that he would marry her, which was not a lie. He wanted to marry her, but as we will see that later he won't be able to marry her because of British laws, because marrying somebody against the parents' wish would mean that the elder son would lose all his inheritance. So we'll come to that later, but at the moment Moll receives the money. Then we see some complication here when the younger brother also falls in love with her. So this is very convincing. If a beautiful young woman lives with a family with young men in it who are not related to her, then this is quite natural that the young men might fall in love and so on. The younger brother also falls in love with Moll, but Moll could not think of being a whore to one brother and a wife to another. So Moll knew or believed that the elder brother would marry her. So she considered herself as his future wife. And therefore it was not possible for her to be a whore to the younger brother. So we would say that here we see that there are some moral scruples in Moll. Even though she accepted money, she did not want to be a prostitute or a whore. She thought that she was accepting the money for somebody who loved her and who would ultimately marry her. Therefore she thought it was not wrong. But with the younger brother falling in love, things become complicated. She cannot reciprocate his love. She upbraids the elder brother that he was like all the rest of the sex, that when they had the character and honor of a woman at their mercy, oftentimes made it their jest, and at least looked upon it as a trifle, and counted the ruin of those they had had their will of as a thing of no value. So she reprimands the elder brother that he was taking her for granted, and he was not doing anything to prevent this circumstance. So the elder brother could prevent the circumstance by marrying her quickly, but he was not ready to do that. And so he found Moll at his mercy, and Moll criticizes him by saying that all the rest of the sex, that is a general blame against the male sex, that they are all opportunists. If they have any woman at their mercy, then they will make the most of the situation, enjoy the woman, but will not think of their precarious situation, and they consider it to be a trifle. So whether the woman's interest is taken care of or not, that is not considered. So that would lead to the ruin of these women. So this was a kind of general accusation against the patriarchal system where men had more power over women. Pages 32 to 36. The name of the younger brother is Robin. Robin expresses his love and determination to marry Moll. Of course, the younger brother does not know that his elder brother also loves Moll. The elder son advises her to marry Robin. So the elder son plays a duplicitous role. He tells her that she should marry him, marry Robin. And as a result, Moll falls ill, falls sick. A quote from the novel, "The bare loss of him as a gallant was not so much my affliction as the loss of his person, whom indeed I loved to distraction, and the loss of all the expectations I had, and which I always had built my hopes upon, of having him one day for my husband. These things oppressed my mind so much that, in short, I fell very ill. The agonies of my mind, in a word, threw me into a high fever, and long it was that none in the family expected my life." So what do we see here? We see that Moll was faithful to the elder brother and dreamt of marrying him. So that would have been the most natural thing for a woman, to marry somebody that she loves. But the social circumstances did not permit it, and she was kind of forced or persuaded to marry somebody that she did not love. When she was considering these things, the tremendous pressure on her mind led to her sickness. She fell sick. So we will see that in future, Moll will marry a number of times, but all those marriages would be for the sake of convenience, because society at the time was such that a woman, whatever her age, could not live alone unless she was married. So a spinster did not have much reputation in society. So this relationship with the elder brother is perhaps the most genuine love relationship in Moll's life. And in this one genuine love relationship, she is unable to marry the man she loves. So here is a failure, and we see that marriage will not mean the same thing for Moll in future. Because as she would grow older, marriage would mean more important for the sake of security than for the sake of love. So the love, or one may say the first love, the first genuine love in one's life, that can never be replaced or repeated again in future in one's life. So Moll knew that she was going to lose the elder brother as a lover, as a gallant, but she also was oppressed by the thought of loving somebody, thought of marrying somebody that she did not love. The mother interrogated Robin and the sister spoke to him. So everybody asks Robin, what is the matter and why Mall fell sick, or why Mall is not ready to marry him and so on. Finally, they entrusted the elder brother with settling the issue and speaking to both. So the whole family, including the mother, told the elder brother to speak to Mall and settle the issue. Now they knew that the elder brother had influence over Mall, but they did not know about their secret relationship or their secret love, let alone the question of their marriage. So the elder brother played a duplicitous role once again. He tells Mall to forget what happened between them, and as compensation for the advantages he had taken with her, gives her £500. So that is the solution that the elder brother always has, that he always wants to, you know, compensate for any loss or any advantage taken with money. Thus, in a word, I may say, he reasoned me out of reason, and I began to see a danger that I was in, which I had not considered before, and that was of being dropped by both of them and left alone in the world to shift for myself. So when the elder brother persuaded Maud to agree to marrying Robin and gave her £500, then Maud was aware for the first time that if she refused to marry Robin, then she would ultimately lose both of them. And of course the family won't agree to keep her with them any longer. So she will lose her shelter, she will lose her lover, and she will lose the prospect of marriage. So we see the desperate condition of Mall as a character who does not have any security, because she does not have a home of her own, she does not have her own parents. She is always, you know, dependent financially and in every way upon others. Therefore, she does not have many choices. And such desperation at a young age makes her in future more determined to take revenge upon this unfair system where women are often helpless and often forced to, you know, do things which they won't do voluntarily, like even accepting somebody for marriage where she does not want. And that is why we see that later Mon looks at the whole issue of marriage as some kind of a competition, some kind of a game where she must defeat the other party, whether with the help of tricks or cunning or whatever. So she looked upon the question of marriage as one where, as a game where in the patriarchal society men had always an advantage over women. So in some way Defoe presents Mall as a rebel figure against patriarchy. Mall denies the younger brother. Yes.
So what does the phrase, what figure?
Which phrase? Which phrase I could not
hear. Defoe considered Mall
A rebel figure. Rebel.
R-E-B-E-L.
Rebel figure against patriarchy. Mall denies the younger brother sex on the night of marriage. So usually that would be looked upon as, you know, cruel or at the least unusual, because the first night always has a charm, and not everybody but many people expect sex on the first night. However, Mall was against this marriage, therefore she denies Robin sex on the first night, but Robin did not notice it because he was too drunk. Robin does not realize that he was drunk. However, she lives with her for 5 years and had 2 children by him, after which Robin dies. So obviously, this was only a symbolic act of rebellion, because Moll did not want to marry Robin. She was forced to marry him. But she does not persist in this, or could not persist in this, and she had 2 children with Robin. And unfortunately, after 5 years, Robin dies. And then Moll is left a widow with £1,200, including the £500 she got from the elder brother. That means that when Robin, her first husband, dies, then Moll has £1,700, which is not a little sum, which is quite a good amount of money. So £1,200 she gets from her husband, and £500 she had got from her lover, the elder brother. Therefore, we may say that this is not a very ideal, moral situation, where the woman benefits both from the husband and the lover. But Moll could not live the life of a chaste, middle-class woman, because originally she was not one. Probably her mother was a working-class woman, and she was very poor. She was a thief. So Moll had the most unusual kind of, beginning. So it is not expected that she would be able to always be, a chaste woman like a woman of the middle class. And she herself admits that when she was young, she had more of vanity and less stock of virtue. However, even though Moll is a, picaresque heroine, or a rogue, she later becomes a thief, a criminal, and so on. But even then, Defoe manages to retain the reader's sympathy for her. And I suppose that one of the reasons of that is that Moll is a woman. And as a woman, she is always the underdog in patriarchal society. Secondly, she belongs to a poor class of people. So she is doubly marginalized. She is marginalized as a poor person, and she is doubly marginalized being a woman. Therefore, the reader's sympathy lies with her. Page 50, Moll was quoted by many tradesmen, among which she found a linen draper. So you will see that in England at the time, the businessmen of various kinds or various professions, or men tradesmen who dealt with different kinds of goods, drapers dealt with clothing or curtains and so on. They were also gentlemen. They were middle class people. So she found a linen draper. Quotation: "I had been tricked once by that cheat for love, but the game was over. I was resolved now to be married or nothing, and to be well married or not at all." So, love with capital letters. So Moll says that this love is the pursuit of every young woman when she is romantic, she falls in love. She pursues this ideal, of love. But as Moll learned from her experience, that one is often cheated in the game of love. How was Moll cheated? She could not marry the person she loved, and her lover instead gave her money and refused to marry her. So now Moll, as she grows older, she develops an attitude that love should not be prioritized. On the other hand, it should be marriage. Why marriage? Because marriage gives a woman a status in life, a status in society. So Maul's position earlier was that of a concubine with the elder brother, then the wife of the younger brother. So that gave her status, and now she is more interested in status and security than in love. Well, at last I found this amphibious creature, this land-water thing called a gentleman tradesman. Very interesting comments and very humorous also. So, a tradesman, a trader dealing in clothes or drapery. Now he is also a gentleman, though there is some dichotomy. A tradesman is not or has not always been gentle. But as in English society, the gentleman status was coveted by everybody. So people from all professions, they moved from the lower status in society to the higher status by becoming a gentleman. So Maul exposes the unnaturality of this status by calling a gentleman draper, a gentleman tradesman, an amphibious thing. Thus my pride, not my principle, my money, not my virtue, kept me honest. Though, as it proved, I found I have much better have been sold by my she-comrade to her brother than have sold myself as I did to a tradesman that was rake, gentleman, shopkeeper and beggar altogether. So it is, Maul says, it is her pride or vanity that she won't marry below the status of a gentleman, that kept her safe. She says that my she comrade, her friend, tried to sell her off to her brother. But a tradesman, even though might be called a gentleman, but he is also a rake. A rake was an 18th century character who promiscuously spent a lot of money after drinking, merriment, and chasing women, and so on. Hogarth, the great artist, great painter of the 18th century, has a series of paintings on the progress of the rake. We see an intimate picture of English society at that time. So a gentleman, if he is a rake and if he loses his money by spending extravagantly, then in no time he will turn into a beggar. So this is how Maul describes the man, that a tradesman, rake, gentleman, shopkeeper, beggar, all together. Vanity is the perfection of a fop. My husband had this excellence. So we have another term, fop. So you remember your study of the Rape of the Lock, where the baron, he is a fop. So fop means a gentleman who is more interested in fashions. We have a term fop for such a man, or a coxcomb, and so on. So such a man has too much of arrogance or overconfidence, vanity. So Maul says that my husband had this foppery, this vanity, in a great proportion. My husband had this excellence that he valued nothing of expense. In about 2 years and a quarter he broke and was not so happy to get over into the mint, but got into a sponging house, being arrested in an action too heavy for him to give bail to. So he sent for me to come to him. So the probability of somebody making quick money by trade or by trick, and also the probability of somebody losing money very fast and becoming a bankrupt, both these probabilities were there in the 18th century society. And the Mint, you remember, is a district in London where it was the under the jurisdiction of the Treasury. And nobody could be arrested there for debt. So those who were bankrupt, they would go to the Mint. But this man, when he quickly broke in 2 years and a quarter, then he did not want to go to the Mint, but he got into a sponging house, being arrested in an action too heavy for him to give bail to. That is, he got arrested and he did not get bail. And then he sent for Moll to come to him. So he was helpless. He was arrested in a sponging house, which means in jail actually. And he asked for Moll to meet him. He told Moll to rob the creditors and get away with £100 or £200 out of goods of the shop before the creditors could arrive with the order of the commissioner to confiscate the goods. So he was a shopkeeper, he was a draper. Therefore, in his shop, there was still some unsold goods, which were mainly cloth or drapery. And he secretly told Moll, his wife, to rob the creditors by taking all this cloth away from his shop, because very soon the commissioner would come and confiscate the goods, so that by selling the goods they could compensate the creditors. But this is of course a criminal activity, to try to steal the cloth that actually now belonged to the creditors. Moll had a child with this man, but he was buried. Moll could muster at most £500 by selling the goods from the shop. So Moll had no qualms about this. She secretly took away the clothes, the goods from the shop, and got £500 by selling them. I was a widow bewitched. I had a husband and no husband, and I could not pretend to marry again, though I knew well enough my husband would never see England if he lived 50 years. So the gentleman, he ultimately managed to flee to France. So Moll lost her husband in this predicament, that she was not a widow. Her husband was alive, but she would never meet her husband because he won't be able to come back to England in the next 50 years or next 30 years till he attained the age of 50. Because if he came, then he would be immediately arrested and prosecuted. Which means that Moll lost her husband for good. At the same time, her husband was not dead, nor was she divorced. So she calls herself a widow bewitched. So her position was like that of a widow, but actually she was not a widow. The first thing she did was to leave the area she knew and called herself Mrs. Flanders. So now that Moll once again is all alone, she has to fend for herself. She of course has some money with her, but she now has to take recourse to cheating and trickery. Alright, so I think time is up. So I'll stop here. Okay. Do you have any questions?